All right, my friends, we're going to spend some time looking at the Word of God. What an amazing privilege. We are in a series right now in the book of Philippians. We've very creatively titled the series Philippians, and the subtitle is Peace, Joy, and Humility. Three words that don't often go together. Many people are searching for peace. Many people are searching for joy. Who adds in that humility is really the path to peace and joy? That's the truth, one of the deep truths that's brought forward in the book of Philippians. We'll remind a little bit. This is just the second message. We'll be in this book for about 8 weeks total through the rest of the summer. Each week we have a sermon illustration. And our illustration for this week is going to be some SpaceX failures. And I'll show you why that is in a minute. But first, as soon as I cue it, we're going to watch a video of all the different times, well, actually not all of them, many of the different times that Elon Musk and his company SpaceX were launching rockets, trying to get them to work, and they failed miserably and exploded in gigantic balls of fire all over the place. Sometimes you try stuff and it doesn't work. Let's watch Elon Musk fail here a little bit, and then we'll talk about this sermon illustration. All right, let's go ahead and fade out that video. It goes on for a while. You get the idea, right? Let's give a round of applause for all the failed rocket launches. That's a lot of fun. So why do we bring up all these failed launches? I love how some of them, it looks like the rocket is it going to fall? Is it going to fall? And then it just tips really slowly, and then there's just a massive explosion right afterwards. So SpaceX, as Elon Musk was, you know, beginning the program, SpaceX didn't do well for a long time. And in fact, Musk knew that it might not do well going in. This is a quote from him. He thought that there was greater than 90% chance. This is before he invested, before he even began the company, that both SpaceX and Tesla would end up being worth $0. He invested hundreds of millions of his own dollars into these companies. Right? And SpaceX came very close to bankruptcy. In fact, they began and they said, okay, we have just enough money. And this was with Elon putting in most of his own fortune. We have just enough money to try 3 rocket launches. And the first one failed, exploded. The second one failed and exploded. What do you think happened the third time? It failed and exploded. And instead of giving up, he went back and found more funding, pretty much zeroed himself out personally, put all of his funds into it to try one more time, a fourth time, and the fourth launch succeeded. And now SpaceX, I don't know, I don't think I have any SpaceX quotes up here about where they're at now, but I think they certainly do more than a third of worldwide space launches. The company is worth billions and billions of dollars at this point. Amazing. I think the 2021, it was worth like $100 billion or something like this. So the question on this illustration is a couple of things. Number one, how did he keep going? Where did that come from, that that fire that even when he failed his original plan, you know, and all of it, the first three launches failed, where did the fire come from to try again and risk everything, to go all in? Where did that fire come from? And how was he able to push through? Here's another quote from him. This is talking about the three launches. I thought, okay, we can afford three launches. And then the third one failed. It was a very, very painful exercise. Where did the fire in him come from to walk through that? That painful, very, very painful exercise and come out the other side? So I'll say the main thing here, and we'll use it in kind of two different ways in the message this morning. The main thing, if you know about Elon Musk, he's kind of weird, yeah? Super weird guy. He's not a Christian, although it seems like he's been moving closer and closer to faith in some ways. But he believes, this is a screenshot from the SpaceX website, and it's all about, I won't read the whole quote to you, but it's all about the mission to colonize the planet of Mars. And this is what drives Elon Musk and his whole team. It's not just to get rockets into space or to make money for their company. That would not have given them the fire to succeed. That would not have brought him to the place where he could risk everything again and again to try and get there. In fact, he could have had almost as much money as, well, more money than anyone could ever spend if he had just taken what he had from PayPal, that's what he did before SpaceX and Tesla, and he just invested it in safe investments. He would have still had tens of billions of dollars. It's not about the money. He believes very firmly that the destiny of the human race is to colonize Mars and then other planets. Now, I'm not going to get into whether that's our destiny or not. To me, that mission doesn't really matter that much. It doesn't matter. Actually, it did to me at one point in my life when I was about 10 years old. Really, when I was about 10 years old, because I believed that all that really existed was the physical, what we could see. And if that's all that really exists, then it seems like getting out there to see what else is there must be the most important mission that there is. And if death is really the end of an individual human being, then we've got to keep the species going somehow. That's Elon Musk's driving vision. That Earth might die out at some point, but if we've colonized many other planets, okay, we don't need to get into that. But you can see that his drive is deep. He has a deep purpose. And that's why he's able to walk through fire. This is the same thing the Apostle Paul is talking about, but his goal, our goal, is much, much more important than Elon Musk's goal. It really doesn't matter whether Mars gets colonized or not, because the physical is not all that there is. There is life after this life. And there is a destiny for the human race that's beyond anything anyone has even imagined yet. And it's that destiny that we're living for. If we live for that, then we can walk through fire. If we live for that, we can risk it all again and again, because the all that we have right now doesn't really matter that much. The book of Philippians, this is a huge key, especially in chapter 1, which we started last week and we're looking at today. This is a huge key. Paul is going to say, for me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. For Elon Musk, to colonize Mars is life. And therefore, even if he lost everything, it would have still helped the goal be achieved by someone. You see it? If to live is Christ, and to die is gain, then it doesn't matter what happens to me. It only matters if Christ is proclaimed, if the gospel is put forward, if people come to know him. A couple of things about the book of Philippians. We've already said it's about peace and joy. The pathway to peace and joy is humility. We'll look at that in more detail when we get to chapter 2. Next week we'll be starting into chapter 2. Chapter 2 is the great humility chapter, the Christ hymn. Today's message is called Struggle for a Great Purpose. Elon Musk is struggling for a very great purpose. Not the greatest, but it's a very ambitious purpose. we struggle for the greatest purpose that exists or can ever exist. And if we know that, it will change everything about how we are. A reminder, we did this last week, but just I think I want to keep giving you a picture of some highlights from the whole book of Philippians, just so you could, as you walk away at the end of the series, have a sense of Paul's message as a whole, the message of the book as a whole. In chapter 1, we've got this key verse, to live is Christ and to die is gain. In chapter 2, we're taught to have the same mindset, the mind that Christ himself had. And that's the mindset of humility. In chapter 3, we find out all the stuff is so connected to what we're talking about today. Chapter 3, we're going to find out that everything that he wanted before in this life, all the stuff that human beings are living for and that Paul had been living for, compared to knowing Jesus, that stuff's worse, it's less than worthless by comparison. It's like a loss. He considered everything a loss compared to the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, his Lord. This is how he was able to walk through fire and keep going. And in chapter 4, we'll see the culmination of all this, if we're really living for Christ, and then if we're really able to follow him in his thinking in a mindset of humility, we're able to cast away a grip on the things of this world. This is the secret to how we arrive at peace and joy. This is the secret. And this is why our world, which doesn't do any of those things, is so anxious, so tense, so stressed, because they don't know the secret and they're not able to enter it because they're not in Christ. Do not be anxious about anything. We simply live our lives with our hands open, presenting our requests to God. And then the peace of God, which transcends understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Think about the things that are good, he says in that same chapter. And then in the very, very end of chapter 4, which is the end of the letter, it's just 4 chapters, he says he's learned the secret of being content. Content, another word for content is happy, right? Everyone in our world is racing around trying to figure out how they can make themselves happy. They're almost everyone is on the wrong track. You cannot become happy by pursuing happiness. It's the wrong way. The secret of being content in any and every situation. Whether you're hungry or well-fed, whether you're living in plenty or you're in want, the secret is this. I can do all things through him who gives me strength, through Christ Jesus. Powerful, powerful. We're encouraging you to memorize scripture this week. I'm actually going to skip over this part this week. I did chapter 2 last week, but maybe I'll do it for you. Chapter 2, first 5 verses of chapter 2. You can just leave it on the screen there. I'll just say it out loud. This is the beginning of the humility, right before the humility hymn. Therefore, if you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any common sharing in the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one spirit and of one mind. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, consider others more valuable than yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of the others. This is freedom. We sang a song about freedom earlier, and as we go through this, one of the things you can keep in mind is Paul is writing this from prison. He is literally in the dungeon of a palace, and he is completely free. He is more free than almost anyone you've ever met in your life. It doesn't matter where he is. Do you want to be like that? I want to become like that. I want to become like that. Lord, help us. Okay, there's the verses I just read for you. I won't let you look at them. You could see if I made any mistakes that way. All right, last week, a little reminder of where we're at. We opened up the letter and looked a little bit through chapter 1 last week. And just a reminder of some of the key points, okay? Once again, in Philippians, just like in Colossians, which we finished up a couple weeks ago, the goal is not just to become a Christian. The goal is not just to get as many people to pray and say, yes, Jesus, I want to follow you. Please forgive me through the cross. That is very important. It is vital. But it's not the end goal. The end goal is for everyone to become mature in Christ. We are brought into a relationship with God through Jesus. Okay, God loves us. He made us. We turned away from him. Jesus died on the cross so that we could come back to him. That's for a purpose, so that he can then change us on the inside, making us into the people we were really created to be. If you become like that, that's when the gospel really starts to spread, when people become not perfect, but more and more like Christ in significant ways. If you can make real progress in this, this is what changes the world. The goal is to become mature in Christ. And we saw last week, looking at this idea, Paul says he's been very bold, right? And he's in prison. We said that he's been so bold. He preached to an entire crowd of thousands in Jerusalem. He preached a sermon to them after they wanted to stone him to death. He got up and preached a sermon to them. And then about halfway through the sermon, they did not like his sermon. They tried to stone him to death again and tried to overwhelm the security guards, the Roman soldiers who were trying to protect him. They tried to swarm him and kill him in the middle of his sermon. So, no matter how bad my sermons get, no one's tried to kill me in the middle of a sermon yet. So, I'm doing all right by God's grace. But Paul's point here was that he's been very bold for the gospel. And as a result, he's lost everything personally. Okay, he's in jail. His church is not very big, right? At this point, his church is like 5 people. Now, one of them happens to be the king, but because the king would come and listen to him preach. But it's like the king and his family. That's it. That's his whole church. He's in jail. But other people are becoming more and more bold for the gospel because of what he's done. And so he rejoices. Because boldness advances the gospel even if you lose. Now, this is where I'm going to use part of the Elon Musk sermon illustration. He was able to shoot all those rockets up. He didn't, of course, he wanted to succeed, right? But I think Musk knew that even if SpaceX failed, he would have advanced his goal of the human race getting closer to Mars. You see that? So because his goal was such a lofty goal, right? That is a pretty big goal, to get to Mars. It's not as big a goal as getting people into eternal life. It's not. But it is a pretty big goal. Because his goal was so big, even if he personally failed, it's okay because he knew he would have advanced the goal. This is how Paul is thinking, but about an even greater goal. The goal of bringing people to know their Lord. The goal of reaching that eternal kingdom. You don't want to, there's not even any air on Mars. You really want to, no, you don't want to go to Mars, okay? But the new kingdom, the new heaven and earth that God will create, now that's a place that you actually want to be. So much better than this life we now live that we can't even imagine the difference yet. We can just glimpse it in little bits as we get to know God by his Spirit. So, for us, for Paul, even if he ended up thrown in jail or with his head cut off, which he eventually did end up with his head cut off, he knew that he would advance his real goal. He wasn't living to build a church himself necessarily or to have any particular kind of life. He had laid down his goals, his plans, his dreams. He was living to advance the gospel. And so even if he loses... And so this is true for us as well, guys. Whether our church becomes humongous and lots of people come to know Jesus, or whether we just do our very best, even if summer fun at the park were to flop, which it won't because Karen's organizing everything, and God's Spirit is good and he's with us, even if we were to lose in the things we try, if we're bold for the gospel, the message, the real goal will advance. Even if our own life is not maybe what we would want. This is what it means. To live is Christ, and to die is gain. To physically die, yes, is gain. also to die, to have our dreams die, our own plans die, if that happens as a result of us going after Christ, it is gain for us. That's what he's going to tell us in greater detail in chapter 3. Let me read some of these verses now from the second half, starting a verse, second half of chapter 1, starting at verse 21. For me, Paul says, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Now, it struck me this morning in Bible study, often things strike me in Bible study because, you know, it's really not just when we even look at the Word of God ourselves, God speaks to us that way, but when we look at it together with others, often God speaks to us through each other in powerful ways. And actually, God spoke this to me through some other people this morning, that what we see here, it's so remarkable. Paul, he could say to them, it should be the case. It could be a command. You guys should be living for Christ. You should be believing that to die is gain. But he doesn't even do that. He trusts God so much. He just simply is telling them what's already become true for him. Paul at this point is closer to the end of his life. Not right at the very end, but closer to the end. He's in prison. But he is rejoicing because of what God has done in him. He has grown in maturity. He's grown in faith. And so he's free, even in a prison. You see, what he's saying to them in this verse is, guys, it doesn't really matter that I'm in jail. Don't be so sorry for me. You know, he doesn't even ask them to pray that he'll get out of jail. He never asks that. What he asks is, don't worry about me. Don't worry about me getting out of jail. Pray for the guards. Pray for the palace guards who are holding me prisoner. Pray that they'll come to know Christ. That's the only thing that matters. And as he says it, you can see he's free. He's free. For me to live is Christ. To die would be gain. I hope it happens. That's what he says next. If I'm to go on living in this body, that's going to be fruitful labor for me. Why? Because he's so great? No, because he has faith and he knows God will work in him. Yet what shall I choose? I don't know. He's saying here, he's wrestling between the choice, would I want to keep living or would I want to die? What? I'm torn between the two. Paul's not sick. He's not in pain. I mean, he is in jail, I guess, but it's not because he's suffering so much that he's torn between the two. It's because death means he will immediately be with his Lord in a much deeper way. And he can see that so visibly, so tangibly in front of him that he's drawn to it far more than to this life, which really is the suffering, isn't it? I'm torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. But it's more necessary for you that I remain in the body, he says. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain, and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you again, your boasting in Christ Jesus will abound on account of me. So, God has put Paul through many things at this point. When Paul first became a Christian, God said to him through another believer, I will show you how much you have to suffer for me. Now that might sound, like his life was going to be so terrible, but what God was doing through that suffering was really changing him on the inside, making him more and more mature. And at this point in his life, he has become, not perfect, but a very mature believer. And because of that, he is walking in peace and joy and freedom, no matter what happens to him. What he's saying here is, I know that God's going to keep me around for a little while because you guys need to get there. I want to see you also arrive where I have arrived. I want to see you walking, not in stress and anxiety, terror about what might happen in this life. I want to see you walking in peace and in joy no matter what's happening to you. I was talking last night, we had this wedding. Some of us were there, this wedding for Joel and Maddie. You can clap for them even though they're not here. Just maybe they'll see it or, you know, one of their friends or their brother will tell them that we clapped for them and cheered for them. So at this wedding, I was talking with an old friend who was there at the wedding. And this old friend had just gone through some stuff in his life over the last year or so that would cause really almost any human being in our natural self would be just super stressed and scared by these things that had happened to him. And I asked him about what that experience was like. How are you doing? And he was overjoyed by that experience. Why? Because it was fun? No, it wasn't fun. Because he could see the progress that God had made in him. He said, I'll tell you, this is the first time in my life, he said, that I've walked through an experience like this, and I can honestly say I didn't have one anxious thought. He said, I walked through it, and I just knew that God's hand was in this, and that something, he was going to bring it to a great conclusion. And so in these things that would have caused me before to be terrified and full of anxiety and stress, I walked through in peace and joy. What? And so you can see a moment like that. Have you ever had a moment like that? If you've grown in Christ significantly, you probably had a moment at least a little bit like that. Let me tell you what it's like to be in a moment like that. Now, that doesn't happen always to me, but it has happened to me as well. To be in a situation like that where something that should be destroying you is not destroying you, it's like you have a superpower. If you had a superpower, you'd be super excited to use it. Like, let's imagine for a minute, imagine you could actually walk through fire and not be burned. Like, you could go into a forest fire, walk through the blazing coals and falling trees, and you were perfectly fine every time. What do you think you might spend your time doing? It might be exciting actually to walk through a forest fire if you had that power, wouldn't it? You would probably go do it. You would go into the forest fires on purpose because they can't touch you. This is Paul. On his way to Jerusalem, every church he visited told him the same thing. We can see in the spirit that if you go to Jerusalem, you're going to be bound hand and foot and thrown in jail and abused and mistreated. Don't go. And every person that said that to Paul, he said, I already know. That's why I'm going. I'm ready to die for Christ. They told him, don't go into that forest. There's a forest fire over there. And he said, forest fires don't burn me anymore. That's why I'm going into the forest fire. Do you want to become like this? Let's do it. It takes a long time, okay? It's not going to happen at the snap of a finger, but you can become like this. Paul was a human being just like you and me. Actually, he had a lot of problems, especially when he was younger. Now, another thing, using this illustration, Elon Musk and also Paul, those who live for a great purpose become capable of great things. Elon Musk is living for Mars. That's a pretty impressive purpose. It's caused him to become capable of great things. Truly great things. It's an amazing accomplishment. SpaceX, some of these things he's done. Paul lived truly for the greatest purpose of all. And the more and more you live for that purpose, the greater things you will become capable of. Now, they won't always be flashy things or things that will make you the most famous person in the world. Usually they won't. But they will be things like staying married, being kind to your children, being kind to people who are your enemies, praying, doing the same thing for a very long time because it's what God has called you to do, these kinds of things, serving those who are really, really hard to serve, you will become capable of the greatest things. What's great in God's eyes are not the same things as what's great in the eyes of most human beings. In fact, the greater the purpose that you live for, the greater your endurance will be. Finally, we'll wrap up with this last section of chapter 1. And here you're going to see once again Paul's mindset. It's like he's out of this world, because he is. He's already in God's world. He's going to describe in this section these Philippians that he's writing to. They've just begun to suffer persecution in their town. We don't know exactly what kind of persecution. Probably something to do with the authorities and the police, because that's the kind of trouble Paul had when he was in Philippi. And he says at the end of the letter, they're suffering the same things that they saw him suffer. We don't know exactly what kind, but some significant trouble. People in their society opposing them, being their enemies. And Paul is going to describe that suffering that they're going through as a gift. I almost feel like he does it by accident. God's given you the gift of a forest fire. You get to walk into it. Here's what he says. Whatever happens, my friends, whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in the one spirit, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel, without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. This is a sign to them that they will be destroyed if they don't turn and receive Christ, but that you will be saved, and that by God. Here's where he says it. It has been granted to you. And the Greek word here is the word grace. It's the word charis. It's the word for a gift. It has been given to you as a gift on behalf of Christ, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for him. This is a stunning statement. Persecution breaks out in this church, and Paul is happy for them. He's happy for them because he knows what God's going to do in them and through them as they walk through it. Since you are going through the same struggle you saw I had and hear that I still have. What a vision we are given of life in Christ if we can grow in maturity. It's my hope today that your desire, your deepest desire, will be to become more like him on the inside. Let's pray.